Our Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise your name for being so faithful, for being so merciful to us. We thank you for this beautiful weather, for rain that we needed so much. Please continue to bless us because we need your blessings. We cannot live without you. We cannot live without your blessings. Please help us to understand your ways. Please help us to understand your will in our daily life, every day, where we go. So we have clear vision what you want from us. So we'll worship you in truth and spirit. So when we come actually to you, you will, at the end of our days, you will say, good and faithful servant. And please bless this service. Help us to give our ears to listening to your word and store every word in our hearts so we can be not just listeners, but obedient sons and daughters so we can implement your will, your words, your commandments in our life so we'll be light to this world. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's land, and sinners plunged beneath the flood lose all their guilty stains, lose all.
Dear dying lamb.
Dear dying lamb, thy precious blood shall never lose its bound till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more.
Be saved to sin no more.
Be saved to sin.
Sing it one more time.
I'll
Guys, don't be afraid to sing along. I see a lot of people are still looking at the screen. Are we supposed to sing or just listen? The reason we do this is that is us giving back to Jesus what he did for us. He doesn't need the worship, we need to worship him. So let's just really sing all along. Sing all along.
Seated above the throne in the Father's love, destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, but suffered as if he did. All authority, every victory is yours. And Savior, worthy of honor, awesome in power forever, awesome and great is your name, you overcame.
Power in hand.
Power in hand, speaking the Father's plan. You're sending us out. All authority, every victory is yours. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all our praise, you overcame.
Sing one more time.
We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. And Savior, worthy of awesome in power forever. awesome and great is your name. You overcame.
Let's sing it out one more time.
And Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all our praise, you overcame. Jesus, awesome and powerful.
Really quickly about Sunday school, that's happening after New Year's, guys. It's so awesome to see God working in this community, in the Bryte Church community, and we're growing. We started, you know, it's a small service that we started here, and we're slowly growing. We will have a Sunday school in English after New Year's. You need to sign up now so we can kind of figure out how all the classroom situation will happen and the teachers and whatnot. But that's exciting news. Amen? We can do better than that. Amen? Okay, yeah. I mean, yeah, kids need Jesus too. That's important. I know we're all kind of sleepy. I've got a feeling like we're not sure what this liquid is that's coming down from, you know. We're like in the times of Noah, like, oh, Noah warned us about this. Is it the second flood? No, it's California, and we're finally getting some rain. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. But I do hope you guys are kind of all awake now. We can open up our Bibles to Acts chapter 6 as we continue our series in Acts. Again, that's Acts chapter 6. For those of you that are new, that's going to be about three quarters of the way, maybe a little bit further than that. So closer towards the end of your Bibles. Acts chapter 6. We're going to be talking today, we're going to look at the first part of the chapter primarily today, but we're going to be talking about a very critical point in the ministry of the church. We read a lot about Jesus' teachings, and then we get into the books of the epistles of Paul, and we hear a lot about, you know, again, practical teaching. But Acts has a few chapters that practically identify some of the needs and problems that churches have. And so that's what we're going to do. We're going to kick off in Acts, and we're going to read through the first part of it. We're going to begin with verse 1, and I'll read it, and you guys follow along. Now, in these days, when the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint by the Hellenists arose against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution of food and alms. And the 12 summoned the full number of the disciples and said, "It is not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables. Therefore, brothers, pick out from among you 7 men of good repute, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, who we will appoint to this duty. But we will devout ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word." And what they said pleased the whole gathering. And they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, and Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon. I think I'm Timon, he's in the Bible. And Parmenas, and Nicolaus. Well, nobody knows how to pronounce these names, by the way, guys. So, a proselyte of Antioch. And these they set before the apostles, and they prayed and laid their hands on them. And the word of God continued to increase, and the number of disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests became obedient to the faith. And we continue the chapter then to read about Stephen and all that happened to him. We find the church here, this young church, right? In a moment of weakness, and there's a problem going on. There's something happening here. Maybe there's a failure from the ministers. Speaking of churches that are not perfect and ministers that are not perfect, I want to begin with an illustration. There was a book, a preacher by the name of Maurice Smith, who used to tour all over UK and Europe and the US and preach, and he was with his band leader named Dave. So it so happened that, you know what, before worship, before Dave was, you know, getting ready to start with worship, Maurice was going around and handing out musical notes. I mean, this was before the projector, so he was hanging out the words, the sheet music to all the people in the audience, and there was this young lady that was kind of sitting up front who just did not, she was not complying. She was not taking the notes. All she would say is like, no, thank you. And, you know, she was just in this mode where she was ready to worship, and she's got her eyes closed, and she's just standing there with a smile. But you know what? Maurice was anything but if not persistent. So he just kept forcing, like, no, you've got to take the music. Like, you're going to sing with us. You're going to do this. You're going to sing. Take the notes. And then finally, somebody leaned over and said, Maurice, she's blind. And Maurice, of course, I mean, that's embarrassing. He turns over to Dave and said, all right, Dave, just start singing. Just start singing. And Dave strikes a chord and says, and begins the song, open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus. And now Maurice is mortified and turns around, and the blind girl is just laughing uncontrollably at this point. So everything turned out well. But our churches, we know, we're filled with imperfect people, with imperfect ministers. We're not perfect. And so that's where we find the church here. There's a lot of good here, and that's where I want to begin and look at five qualities of this church. Of five qualities of what I would say is a spirit-filled church. And folks, here's the way I want us to do as we go through this message. We're going to look first at the church, and then we're going to look at the ministers. I want you to relate everything we read today to Bryte Church here, specifically our English service. I really believe that this passage, I mean, just directly correlates and speaks to us today where we are right now. I mean, I don't know if we could find a better passage. So let's read into this and see what God is trying to tell Bryte Church, English service, what God is telling us today, and where he's going to lead us in this kind of next season of our growth and of our life, all right? So we're going to begin here with Acts chapter 6, verse 1, and I'm going to have a lot just on the first verse. Now, in these days, when the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint by the Hellenists arose against the Hebrews because their widows are being neglected in the daily distribution. There's a lot here. We're going to begin with this. The first mark, the first sign of a good, spirit-filled church is growth. There is remarkable growth that we see in this passage. Apostle Luke uses it, because Apostle Luke was the one that wrote this, just for those of you who don't know. He used the word added in chapter 2. He used the word multiplied in chapter 9. 8 times throughout Acts, he's talking about growth, added, multiplied. God put more people in. It's just growing, right? And so what we're seeing here is just this natural progression of a growing church. Folks, you understand a church plant, right? When a church is small, they're all gathering in this one guy's home, right? You call the church number, and you get the pastor's cell phone, right? It just goes directly to his cell. And the Facebook page is managed by his 11-year-old daughter, right? And then people are gathering there every Sunday, and it slowly grows. And all of a sudden, people that were running out of space, people are sitting on the couch like armrests, right? The furniture is getting abused. The cat has PTSD. Because everybody's chasing him around. The kids are there. That's the Sunday school, man. It's just chasing, you know, he's not coming home anymore. We're growing. We don't have space enough in the pastor's home. What do we do? So the church says, well, all right, well, we want to still keep gathering together, so let's go. Let's rent this maybe office space or something in an office complex. Now they're growing again. Now they've got 2 services, maybe 3, maybe 4. And all of a sudden they say, well, we need a Sunday school. We need to take care of the kids. We need a youth program. We've got to keep growing. We've got to take care of these needs, right? And they start that, and they keep, oh, we've got to get a parking ministry. We've got to make sure that we've got security on site, making sure everything's fine, right? And then what happens? Well, we see issues arise in the church because all of a sudden there's people that are coming in and saying, man, I need counseling. My marriage is falling apart. I need my life is falling apart. Man, I'm an ex-drug addict. I need help right now. Dude, I just got out of jail. What do I do with my life? I don't know what's going on. I'm facing abuse at home. Help me, Pastor. And as the church grows, people come in and they need help. Church is not a clean-cut place. Church is a messy place where people come and say, Jesus, we need you. We need help from the community of believers here. What do we do? And so that's what we see here. As the church grows, they're called to take care of the orphans and the widows. We don't have an orphans ministry here in the U.S. We have foster care and all that. But you go to any other country, there are churches that are founded almost exclusively. Some churches are founded almost exclusively to take care of orphans. And these orphans that were 10-year-old kids before now have grown up to be ministers and pastors. It's incredible, this story. So this is a ministry in this church, praise God. And it continues to grow. Now, here's the message and the lesson I want to take out of this single point. Folks, sometimes we traditionally, right? In our church, we say, don't look at the numbers. Nobody wants to look at the numbers. It's like unholy. You feel like, well, are you just doing this for the numbers? You just want more people to come in? Well, yeah, maybe that's not the focus. But by all means, the amount of folks that gather here is a sign also of the health of the church. Not necessarily the number now, but with where it's going. Well, God's not worried about numbers. Well, I don't know why then Luke writes about it 8 times, specifically saying the church is growing. A growing church is a healthy church. Folks, I think we make a mistake sometimes when we look at our churches, and we're fine that we're at 200 people for the last 20 years. And we think, well, yeah, that's fine. And we've got this mentality of, well, let's keep our own, right? Let's save our children. Let's keep our children in church. And we're fine that we've got the same amount of people in the church that we're not looking for another building every 5 years. I don't think that's right. I think we've got to kind of get past that and challenge that assumption. I don't think we should be happy to stay at the same number of people the whole time. I don't know that that's biblical. I mean, if I was still here and I was still the size of a 5-year-old and my mom was, you know, changing diapers, you'd say, Pete, there's something wrong with you. Well, I think we can relate that to the church. There's something wrong if the church has stayed the same size, not even talking about spiritual maturity. I want to throw some statistics out there. And when I heard this, this kind of shocked me. But listen carefully. I get lost in numbers easily, so I'm going to go slow. Statistics. This is relatively recent. A 100-member church that has been around for less than 3 years, meaning brand new church, very similar to what we have here, right? This English service has been around for maybe right around 6 months, right? For less than three years, has 10 converts a year, right? 10 people that have been non-believers that would come in and join the church. 10 converts a year. A 100-member church, same size, that has been around for 3 to 15 years, a little bit longer, has about 5 converts a year. Half of that. A 100-member church that has been around for more than 15 years has 3 converts a year. Are you guys seeing the trend? People become satisfied with the status quo. Oh, we're fine at 100. We're fine. Let's just keep ourselves in church. Let's make sure we're growing. That's our priority. I mean, I heard an older gentleman say, and I pray that this is not the view that we hold here, but he said, listen, you've got to take care of your family and your own before you go telling other people about Jesus. You know? I don't know that that's biblical, brother. I don't think that's what God is saying here. I think God does want us to go out and have converts, have new people come and join. He does care about the growth of the church. He's never said that, hey, 2,000, Bryte, that's it. I want you capped at 2,000 people. That's the building that I've given you. I think we need to grow more, right? And so that's lesson number one. A spirit-filled church should be a growing church. That should matter to us. When we don't see more folks amongst us. Lesson number two, a spirit-filled church is one that has acceptance and diversity. Acceptance and diversity. What we see here, we see two groups of people in the Jerusalem church, in the church of Jerusalem. We see the Hellenists, And the Hellenists were Jews mostly. They could have been people of other nationalities that had been abroad, that lived, you know, in Greece, maybe in Egypt, whatever, wherever they were. But they had kind of soaked in the Hellenistic culture. And Helen doesn't refer to like a Helen, like a Helen Keller, right? And we're not talking about that. But Hellenists meaning the Grecian, right? The culture of the Greek world. It was, you know, very... you know, like artsy-fartsy, right? It was a lot of art, you know, like you spoke Greek, and you were cultured, and you wore the toga the right way. And so these were the people that kind of came back to Jerusalem, and they've been abroad, they're well-traveled, they've got something going on, versus the Hebrews, who were more of the traditional, right? They've stayed home, they were following the law, they were soaked into that rabbinical culture. And so we're seeing a little bit of tension here. We're seeing a little bit of tension. And you're actually going to see that tension even today in Israel. If you go to Israel today, you'll notice that the native Israelis, the guys that have been born there, right? They've been through that whole deal, the experience of living in Israel. They're going to feel superior to the people that, like the American Jews or the Russian Jews. You're going to still have that tension even today. And I can understand. I mean, there's that joke about, like, American Russians going back to Russia and like saying okay way too many times to make sure everybody knows I'm from America. Like, can I get some cheese? Okay, I'm sorry. Am I speaking too much English for you? You know, like I can get that. You know, it's a little obnoxious. You know, and they have a fake accent. Like, oh, I'm from Greece. I'm sorry, I cannot speak the Israeli very well anymore. You know, yeah, you get that, and it's a little obnoxious. I get that. And so the Hebrews are looking at these guys like, dude, just like, it's not cool anymore. We don't care that you've lived in Greece. And these guys are looking at the Israelis like, dude, you guys haven't even traveled and seen the world. You know, and there's tension. We understand that. We see that. And we even have that today. Folks, honestly, we have that today in church, right? If you're more of a redneck, show of hands. They're keeping. All right, you live in California. We've got you. You know, you don't like the city slickers, right? You don't like the guys that are from the city. Yeah, like, dude, I drive a truck. The guy's like, I drive a Prius. Well, we don't like each other, right? There's still some tension. If you're from SoCal, maybe you don't like those NorCal folks. You know, there's tension amongst races. Unfortunately, we see that, right? Oh, you're a Mexican. Oh, you're a different nationality. You're from the Middle East. We see tension there. Language, right? Oh, we don't speak the same language. Or even amongst people that share everything in common, folks, we see that in churches all the time. Well, you sin differently from me. We don't say it that way. We say, oh, he's got a past. Well, yeah, that's what church is about. You've got a past, you know? You're just as big of a sinner. But that's how we Christians like to start to divide things up and create drama, right? Oh, he's different. Man, it's so good that we have Jesus. Without Jesus, we would never be able to get that diverse group of people in this building as we have today, and hopefully it gets more diverse, folks. That's what Jesus is all about. I mean, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 13, for in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one spirit. We share love, right? Without the love of Christ, without that spirit today, there will be people here in the room that we would not agree with, we would not want to hang out with, because, man, I don't want to spoil my reputation, or, man, I don't talk with people of that race or that community. Rich people don't like poor people. Poor people think rich people are obnoxious, right? They're jerks. But today we can sit together and say, man, what can I do to help you, brother? What can I do to be together with you here? Can we share the love? Because we have one spirit. And so again, a lesson, a mark of a spirit-filled church, and that one that I hope we all share here, is that we are diverse and accepting. Lesson number 3, a spirit-filled church serves others. What we see here, you know, we want to stir up a little bit of drama. And we want to say, man, that church in Jerusalem, they've kind of got it wrong. But what we see here is actually a lot of good, because people have come to Jesus. People have come and accepted Christ. And all of a sudden, there's this natural outpouring. The Spirit is working in them. And they're saying, listen, before, I didn't want to donate. I was a Democrat. I wanted the government to take my money with higher taxes and give it away to social work. I'm sorry, guys. Any Democrats in here? God loves you too. That's all right. But now they're saying, listen, I want to give my money away to charity. I understand God's changed me where I need to be out there helping folks. And folks, the fact that the government is helping people in their social work, that's awesome. Praise God for that. That's good. But God's intention has always been for the church to do that kind of ministry. That's the work of the Spirit in the church. We don't just hand it off to the government and say, well, let them do it. They take away taxes on my paycheck. No, that's our job still. God's never left it. So the church here is going out and taking care of the people, and it was right. Now, just to give you a little history, in the Jewish synagogue, where all of this started in the church, in the Jewish synagogues, once a week they would have an offering from the people there, and they would use that money. It was called alms, right? They would use that money to buy food. And so homeless people, older people that didn't have family, widows, orphans, they would come in and they would get 14 hot meals a week. They would get 2 meals a day. And the synagogue would take care of them that way. Because remember, folks, in the old times, there was no such thing as life insurance. Who here has life insurance? Show me. All right, we got a couple. You don't have life insurance. Like, 15 years old, but that's all right. I was filling out life insurance the other week, and that's why I'm bringing this up. And I think, well, what happens if I die? And who's going to take care of my wife, right? You kind of begin to think about that, like, how much money should I leave her? Should I leave her 50%? No, I'm going to leave her 100%, right? I want her to be taken care of. But that back then, you didn't have that. So when the guy dies at 30 because of some disease that they didn't have a cure to, his wife was there with no support. And if she didn't have any other family, maybe they had moved from a different place, she was out there by herself, and so now she's stuck. But luckily, because she's in this body of believers, there are people that are coming to her and saying, sister, we love you. We want to take care of you. Here, have some food. Have some money. Here, take care of your kids. And it's a beautiful thing, man. That's what the church does. That's what the church does when we come together around folks in need, when our eyes are open, our hearts are open, our hands are open, and we say, God, everything you've given me is not yours. It is for me to use to serve the people around me. And that's what we're seeing here in this church as they're helping people, the poor, the widows, the orphans. They're helping them out. I want to thank the youth. Bryte Youth did something very incredible last year where we had a can drive. The Yolo County Food Bank was running low on food, and they reached out to the local churches. That's awesome. They said, listen, you guys are people of God. Can you guys help us out? And I want to show you a picture really quick. Guys, if you could throw it up there. That's kind of tough to see, but this stage was yay high filled with cans. We had cans stacked all the way around the side, all the way to there, and all the way to there. They're showing more pictures, but we had cans all over the place. Thank you, Bryte Youth. That was awesome. We came in and we had just boxes, a whole pickup truck full of food that we donated to the Yolo County Food Bank, but that's what the Spirit does in us. Folks, if we weren't in this community, why would you go out and spend $50, $100 on food for somebody else to eat? But the Spirit inside of us, God, changes us, brings us together, and said, listen, number one commandment is to love me. The number two commandment is to love your neighbor. So praise God for that, guys. Thank you, Bryte Youth. But again, a lesson for us. A Spirit-filled church serves others. Number four, a Spirit-filled church is filled with saved saints, not with perfect people. We have saved saints. We have people that came and were saved through the blood of Jesus Christ, through his grace, not deserving anything themselves, folks. That's the message of the gospel, where we deserve nothing. We all deserve death because of the sin that resides of us. But Jesus Christ is sent as a propitiation for our sins from God to die in our stead in order that we might be washed, our sin might be washed by his death. He takes our place, and now we are saved. We're seen as perfect before God. By no means perfect within ourselves. We fight that daily battle against sin every single day. If you don't, you've lost already. And we have to question whether the Spirit lives in you. But those that are believers, man, it's a tough battle. You guys know it is. You live it. From sun up to sun down, we're fighting that battle as we try to live a perfect life before God and asking for repentance where we mess up. And that's what happens here. We do mess up. We do make mistakes. And it wasn't a huge sin. I mean, the church, it wasn't like the pastor was caught in adultery. And we see that sometimes today on the news, and it hurts us, right? You see that, and they'll plaster it everywhere. Oh, the pastor was caught sleeping with the secretary. Or the pastor was caught, or this guy was caught stealing money from the church. Or we donated $1 million to Haiti, and they built one house, right? That was in the news recently. And that kills you. You think, brothers, you're ruining the name of Jesus. What are you doing? That's not exactly what's happening here. They made a mistake, yes. But we don't see Peter later on calling them to repentance and rebuking them and saying, listen, you guys really screwed up. He said, no, we've got to make a few tweaks here. The church is growing so quickly, we're not keeping up with things, so we've got to start a new ministry. We've got to do something different here. A mistake has been made, but we will address it. Now, folks, some of you here, maybe this isn't the first church that you've been. Most of you here, probably this is not the first church that you've ever been to. You may have been a member of a different congregation with a different community of believers. And some of you are no longer in that community because you were hurt by the actions of the members of the other people there. Issues arise, issues happen. And it's just disheartening to hear stories of folks coming from another service and saying, listen, I went there, And I heard some really rude things in my directions. I went there with my problems, and they turned me away. I went there to talk to somebody about the sin that's going on in my life, and they made light of it. They made fun of it. They turned me away. They didn't want to have anything to do with me. And so they come here, hopefully, where they find acceptance. But man, that hurts you. That hurts you forever. There are folks that are going to come to church one time. There's a story of Mohammed Gandhi who came to a church. He was trying to check out church and see what Christianity was all about. He walks in and they turn him away at the door and say, listen, we don't like your kind here. He turned around and walked out and never came back to a church. He said, if that's the kind of people Christians are, I never want to be a Christian. I don't know who the usher was at that church. We can flog him. We can go after him. I don't know who that was. Maybe he just made a mistake. But there are people that are hurt by the church, unfortunately. Unfortunately. Now, what happens here? What happens here? They bring the need directly to Peter and the apostles, and they said, listen, before any of these widows are turned away, before we hurt another person, before anything else happened, we've got to fix this. We've got to fix this right now. We're not perfect people. We're saved. We want to change things, but we do make mistakes. We've got to understand that, folks. When the Spirit moves in a mighty way, you think about how it did back then. 3,000 people come to Jesus. 5,000 people join the church. More people are multiplying. More people are coming. I mean, some people say that the Jerusalem church was 20, 25,000 people. 25,000 people. I mean, it's huge. But when the Spirit moves that way, sometimes people are caught up in that, and we have people here that think they're believers or want to be believers, but they're not. That's the reality of it. They get caught up in the emotion, oh, my friends are there, I'm going to go there too, right? Oh, man, I love the music. Well, do you believe in Jesus Christ as your Savior? Well, I'm not sure. And then those people go out and reflect Jesus inappropriately, right? So yes, churches are full of all kinds of folks. We understand that. And people make mistakes, we understand that. But there are true believers here that do want to make a change. And that's our fifth point on the church. A church, a spirit-filled church, will be dynamic. It will seek to improve and to change. I want to quote Matt Chandler, Pastor Matt Chandler, who says, "The church needs to change, but not just for the sake of change. We need to modify what we do in order to make disciples in a more holistic way," meaning change with a purpose. Change with the perfect of saving lives, showing love, and studying the Lord. That's our mission statement. Now, we all know there are young people in every church, right, that just want to change things. They're just rebels, like, oh, we're gonna do away with this, and we're gonna do away with this, and I don't like that. There's old people like that too, right? We don't change things for the sake of change. And for the young people that feel that way sometimes, even in this maybe audience, folks, we need to understand young people. We need to understand that there are old things. There are traditions out there that God used to use to bring people to him in a very powerful way. We understand that. Oh, man, I don't want to go to prayer meeting at 6 a.m. Man, there are people saved through that prayer meeting. Well, I don't like to sing slow songs. There were people brought to Jesus through those slow songs. At the same time, for those of you that are maybe older and more traditional, sometimes we make sacred cows, right? We make things sacred, like, well, we've got to do it this way. I was saved through this. We've got to keep doing that. I want to make this super, super practical. And I want to cast a little vision and share something with you guys that I think will get you excited, because I'm super pumped about this. We've always done Sunday school and youth programs and teens programs for our own kids, for ourselves. It's been a way for us to come to church, know that our kids are getting, you know, scripture taught to them. We have summer camps, right? You send them away for a week. You can finally breathe for a week. We have vacation Bible school. Praise God for all of you people, ladies, guys that have just put so much effort into that. Man, I just know the folks that were a part of that. And, I mean, the stress is through the roof. That's awesome. But when I come and I say, that's cool, but how many people do we have from the Bryte Broderick community in our vacation Bible school? How many people do we have in our Sunday school that whose parents are completely unbelievers and we've just drawn these kids in? In our teens program, in our youth program. Well, we've never really done that. We've always been about ourselves. Did you guys know that Sunday school, for example, was founded on non-believing kids? The Christian kids were supposed to sit in the rows with their parents, but the unbeliever kids, the street urchins, the kids that were playing around, Dwight Moody in Chicago went out and got those kids together, and he made a church. I mean, it was a 1,000-person church that he made just out of kids that he gathered together off the streets of Chicago, brought them into an old saloon, and then eventually their parents started to come because they said, we weren't accepted at church. We're going to come here to Sunday school and be with you guys. And that's how it all kind of started. Now, praise God, we do have kids in our program that have unbelieving parents. A small percentage, we do have that. I want to cast some vision and say, folks, we're having conversations right now with our Sunday school directors, with our brothers and our elder board, and saying we want our Sunday school program to be more than just that. We want to take care of our kids, but we want to go out there. And after New Year's, hopefully with our launch of our new English Sunday school, we're going to be going out and aggressively finding kids and saying, let's go. You got to hear about this. It's going to be fun. It's going to be interesting. You're going to hear about something very, very important. Praise God. Amen? We're not going to keep a sacred cow. We've always been doing it this way. No, we're going to be dynamic. We're going to change in order to save lives. We're going to change in order to continue to save lives. We're going to go into back to the Bible, Acts chapter 6 again. I know we kind of spent a lot of time in verse 1, but now we're going to look at some of the ministers and qualities of a minister. So we're going to look, again, let's look at verse 2 and read from there. And the 12 summoned the full number of the disciples and said, "It is not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables. Therefore, brothers, pick out from among you 7 men of good repute, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, who we will appoint to this duty, but we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word. We'll pause there for a second. Five qualities of Spirit-led men, of Spirit-filled men, of ministers. So folks, we saw this church with a problem. There was an issue, and the solution, the Spirit told them, hey, we need men. We need good men to get in here and fix this, and we're going to go forward with a different structure. And so when we look for men, when we look for ministers, when we look for people to jump in for the Word of God, into the work of God, here's the qualities that we need. Number one, we talk about Spirit-filled people. We need a specific calling. Folks, all of you here, as a believer, you have a calling. That is not a suggestion. That is a fact. Whether you know what your calling is up to you and God. But you have a calling. There's a ministry here in church, somewhere in the kingdom of God. There's a ministry with your name on it. Whether you're doing it or not is up to you. And I know we get busy. You know, I heard the phrase a couple of weeks ago and just struck me. I love God, but I have homework. True, right? So true. I love God, but I have kids. And I challenge that person as I challenge myself, and I say, listen, if I told you tomorrow that you don't have to worship God, done. You don't have to worship Jesus. You don't have to believe in anything. Would you breathe a sigh of relief and say, oh, I don't have to get my kids ready for church. Thank you. I have more time for homework and hanging out with people. I don't have to go to comm group. Or would your life just crumble around you and you say, listen, Pete, then I have nothing left to live for. Because I have a calling. I have a ministry. God holds my life together. Folks, each of you have a calling today, but we let stuff distract us. We let stuff distract us. And when Jesus was talking about that parable with the good seed, with the seed and the good soil and the soil with the brambles and the rocks, man, many of us today are the ones with the brambles. We've got that seed that's trying to come up. We know there's a calling. We have that, well, I want to do good things. And we're just drowned out by life around us. We forget that we should be doing something in God's kingdom. We forget that we have a calling. And so, going back to this passage, the apostles understood there's something going on here. There's a need. We need to do with something, but what they don't do is they don't jump in and say, we'll do it then. Fine. Okay, thanks for letting us know. We'll fix it ourselves. It's tough work. Serving tables. Some of you guys have been waiters, right? You guys know. Nobody tips. Russians, at least, you know. But it's tough work. Now, they could have jumped right in and said, we'll do it. But they don't do that. There are some things we have to say no to, right? There are some things that we say, listen, it's outside of my calling. I think Peter is a great apostle. God made Peter to be that rock. Man, Peter could stand in front of the Sanhedrin. He could stand there while he's abused and thrown into jail and beaten and whipped. And he would come out and say, praise God, give me some more. That's the appetizer. Where's the main course? Because I'm doing this for Jesus. Man, that's who he was. He was that tough-as-nails guy you could send anywhere. But you put him behind the Starbucks counter during rush hour when some middle-aged woman is complaining about the fact she doesn't have enough caramel in her macchiato, skinny, triple shot. I don't know what I just said. That's code. But that's not who Peter was, right? Like, he was not a good servant. He could not put a menu together. That's not like, you want some fish? I could do fish. More fish tomorrow. Yeah, we've got fish. You know, you didn't want him serving food. And he understood that. That's not his calling. Folks, honestly, let's be very, very honest. A lot of times we like to load up our pastors and ministers with stuff. Like, well, we've got ministry. We've got to do this. We've got to do local missions. We've got to do something. We've got to start. So, well, pastor, take care of it. Take care of it, pastor. We want you to preach five times and counsel and do marriages and take care of the babies. Do it all, pastor. You do it. You take care of it. And the poor pastor saying, listen, one, it's not my calling. Yeah, I understand there's issues. They never say that taking care of the widows and the orphans is not important. They understood. God loves them. We need to take care of them. But they also understand, Peter and John and the rest of the guys, that's not what we're about. That's not what God needs us to do here. There's a rule that we often refer to in ministry, in the business world. It's called the 80-20 rule. You guys have probably heard about it. Raise of hands who knows about the 80-20 rule. Okay, so I'll share it with you guys. We've got a couple of folks here. The 80-20 rule, it can be applied to many different areas, but in ministry, we talk about this. We say that 20% of the people do 80% of the work. 20% of the people do 80% of the work. And that's so disheartening because Scripture tells us that everybody in here has a gift and a calling. But we look around and we see only 20% of the people involved in ministry doing what they're called to do, doing 80% of the work. And I think for a second, man, what if every single person here, every single person, or maybe as a family unit, they answered that call and said, listen, I know we're going to do something with my family. This is what we're going to do. This is the ministry. We see the need. We're going to do this ministry going forward. And all of a sudden, the people of God rose up and answered the call that God has placed in their heart. Think about the impact that Bryte Church could have on the people around us. Think about the impact that we could have on Bryte Broderick, on West Sacramento, on Sacramento in general. Folks, the kingdom of God would explode here. We would be like this church in Acts 6, where we would look around and there's thousands of people coming in, right? That's natural, that's fine. We've got the Hellenists, we've got the Hebrews, we've got all different nationalities in here. And we're coming to the pastors and saying, we need more leaders because everybody's involved. I'm going to share another secret with you. As we put together the vision for our English service, as we talk with the elders and the brothers, our goal is that next year we can involve 80% of the people in this congregation in the ministry. That's a healthy church. 80%. So, folks, I'm going to be very clear. If you're not in a ministry today, if you're not realizing your calling in the kingdom of God, there's an iPad out in the foyer. By all means, sign up. By all means, put your name in and say, listen, I'm raising my hand. I want to talk to somebody about what my calling is. That's the goal for next year because we believe that what Scripture says here is true. We're going to follow it. We're going to pursue God's vision for this church. That's important. Dr. Bob Utley was quoted. He said, my greatest temptation sometimes is doing good. Good is the enemy of best. Sometimes we put so much on our pastors. We make the people, the 20%, do everything, and they don't have time to focus on the best. You know, you can imagine if the apostles were out there serving food, they come on Sunday and they don't have a sermon prepared. It's not a good deal. So our goal here is going to be to unload our leaders, our pastors, those that are in ministry, to come in and join them, stand alongside of them so that they have time to cast vision, to work with people, to raise up the next generation of leaders so that we're prepared to handle all the folks that are going to soon fill this place. Amen? We can do better than that. Amen? Okay, I'm glad we're on the same page. That was 20% of the people here saying amen. We can do better. We can do 80. All right. Next, the sign of a spirit-led minister, somebody who's answered their call, is commitment. Now, that's not expressly written here, but we see that commitment. Leadership tip for those of you that are leaders in the business world or somewhere else. In the business world, it's phrased like this. You always want passion over talent. You want to take somebody that's passionate about your company over somebody who's super talented in that one little specific deal. In the Christian world, we say we want somebody who's a mature believer, who's committed to that ministry, over somebody who's just uber talented, over somebody that's uber talented. I'll put it this way. Serving the tables is not like the most important work, right? It really isn't. Like, you're a glorified waiter. If you go to a wedding today, who do you have serving the tables? Like, you know, 14, 15-year-old girls, guys, right? We see that. Do you see, like, Pastor Leo out there? Like, you want some mushrooms? I got some Russian mushrooms. They've got a lot of garlic. Would you like some? We don't see our elders out there, right? So in our minds, we look at that position and we think, well, it's not like a really glorified position. It's not like, why would you stick? I mean, Peter and the apostles should have been like, do we have any 15-year-old girls here that are just on fire for the Lord that want to do this? But instead they say, listen, we want men that are committed, that are on fire for with the Spirit, they're wise. They list out all of these requirements. And I think when we look at all of that, we go back to the scripture, the passage in Luke 16, verse 10, where Jesus says, one who is faithful in a very little, in very little, is also faithful in much. And one who is dishonest in very little is also dishonest in much. So he's saying, listen, we're going to have to test to see how well you do in a small ministry before we promote you. And it's crazy to see the people that they got here. I mean, these were such committed men. Such commit. I mean, if Stefan walked in today, we wouldn't send him back to Revelation Roast. We would be like, dude, can you be like the head pastor? Can we like get you on the elder board? This is crazy. Like, you're such a great person. You're like a spiritual hero. But no, he said, we're going to start you off small and we're going to let you grow. And that's how many great leaders are raised, folks. I remember, even myself when I was younger, you know, you don't just begin to preach right away. I started off doing sound, you know. Friday nights, nobody comes to those services. The sound guy was a truck driver. He wasn't there. So I'm sitting back there trying to minimize the feedback, you know, while my dad is speaking, you know. So you learn pretty quickly, like, dude, I'm going to get it right. And then you go into teens, and then you start doing other things, and you're vacuuming the floors late at night, and you kind of grow into your ministry. That's what we do in our youth group, right? As we raise people up from ministry to ministry. So you grow into something because you're committed. What we see a lot today of, and this is just a side remark, we see guys going to seminary, and as soon as they stop, you know, they're done with seminary, they get their bachelor's, master's, doctor's, whatever, and they say, all right, you're a pastor now, go do it. And we see these guys, these newly minted pastors dropping off the face of the earth after a couple of years. They couldn't handle it. What's happening? Pastor Alex Kolomitsev from Word of Grace Church, you know, was asked the same question, and he said, listen, we don't have committed leaders anymore. These guys just don't have commitment. They've got the knowledge and the talent, and they can talk your ears off, but they don't have commitment. And so that's what we're looking for. We're looking for folks that have a calling, and Spirit-filled ministers will have commitment. Now, there's three more qualities that are brought up by the apostles themselves. They talk about good repute, a good reputation. So, again, somebody who's working in the kingdom of God, participating, answered their calling, they're going to have a good reputation. And you think, why do you need a good reputation to be a waiter? Like, you can send your ex-cons over there. Like, oh, you just got out of prison? We're not going to put you in child care. You go do the waiting, you know? Here's why a good reputation is important. There's a story about a lady that was very promiscuous, and she would go around to all the bars and the clubs and all the places and, you know, wherever she could dance with folks, and she lived a very promiscuous lifestyle. And eventually, she got to just a deep, dark place in her life, where she realized she couldn't keep going this way, and she said, I gotta find God. I've gotta change. Something's gotta change. So that Sunday she dresses up and she goes to church, and as she comes in the church doors, she sees the greeter out front, and she recognizes the guy as one of the guys that hung out at a club while always trying to pick up ladies, you know, on Saturday nights. She turned right around, walked out, and went down the street to the next church. And she talked to the pastor there, and she said, listen, I enjoyed the service, everything, but I was up the street earlier this morning at this other church, and I saw this guy, and I don't know if I did the right thing, but I can't go to a church where I saw the guy the night before drunk at a club. I can't go to a church like that. Did I do the right thing? And the pastor assured her that, yes, he said, I don't think I could have gone to that church either. I understand what's going on. But it's a call out for all of us here as believers. Folks, a good reputation, we like to say, well, I don't care what people think about me. I don't care. I'm going to just do me. That's the phrase, right? I'm just doing me. I don't care what people say. I'll be myself. Well, guess what? Yourself is not good enough for God. One, he wants to change you. Two, and three, your reputation is very important. You represent God. You represent God out there. And so let me ask you this. If today we took a picture of you, put it on Facebook, and tagged you that you were a Bryte church, would your friends be surprised? What? You go to church? You? Like, were you just passing through? Like, how did you end up there? I wonder, what's our reputation like? You know? Do people find us Friday night with a shot of whiskey in our hand telling them, you got to learn more about Jesus? Is that the kind of reputation and ministry that we're carrying out there, right? Good reputation, that was important. Next, spirit-filled. The apostles say a minister of God needs to be spirit-filled. And now, I don't want you to mistake this and downplay this, because when we say spirit-filled, some of you guys are thinking spiritual. Generally spiritual. Oh, that guy's religious. Oh, he's just a nice guy in general. I think he believes in a God. These men were spirit-filled. Now, rewind. A month ago, we were talking about who the Holy Spirit was. The Holy Spirit is God. There is God the Father who resides in heaven right now. There is God the Son who came down, died for our sins, and went back to be with the Father until the second coming, when he will come and take us with him. And we will be joined together. He is the groom. We are the bride. And there is God, the Holy Spirit, that is here on earth right now doing supernatural things in the children, in the church of God. He leads us. He guides us. There's stuff happening. And these men were filled with the Spirit. They weren't just generally spiritual. They were filled with the Spirit. And just look at what happened, Stephen. I mean, he was the first martyr. We're going to read about it. I mean, I'm not going to, spoiler alert, he dies, right? So still come next Sunday. Please come to the sermon next Sunday. We'll talk about Stephen some more. But, I mean, the speech, the passion that he had before the Sanhedrin, incredible. And then you see Philip, you know, and Philip goes out and led by the Spirit to this low, and he speaks to the eunuch there from Ethiopia, converts that guy, and tradition says that he basically started the church in Ethiopia, the Christian church in a whole nation. He goes up to Samaria and converts a bunch of people there. I mean, the guy was Spirit-filled. I like the fact we talk about, it says Nicolaus, a proselyte. I mean, think about this, the journey that God took this guy through. He was a Greek, just a heathen living in Antioch, and he was looking for God, so he converts to Judaism. And then he doesn't find God there. He says, I'm close, but I'm not all the way there. And then he hears about Jesus, and he says, that's it. That's the truth. That's where I need to be. And becomes a member of the church and a deacon there, a minister there. How awesome is that? Just somebody who was just hungry for the truth to finding God, find Jesus. These were the kind of men, spirit-filled people. And folks, there's no reason we can't be the same. Honestly, there is no reason we cannot be spirit-filled ministers in the kingdom of God. And finally, the final characteristic is wisdom. Wisdom. A minister in the kingdom of God needs to be wise. And some of you guys are thinking about Solomon right now, right? So Stephen's standing there with the bagel and two widows, like, whose bagel is it? And he says, cut it in half and toast it. Yeah. There's wisdom. We need that wisdom in the church. We have very good ministers. We have very good leaders that have wisdom spiritually, where they can come in and look at a problem in a family or in your life and just discern the root and the cause and give you, just in a sentence, they will give you the answer that you're looking for, that you've been looking for years. We need wise people like that. There are ministers in the church that have good business sense, organizational sense, where they can come in and look at an organization or a group or a ministry, and they can say, listen, we've got to change this, this, and this, and it begins to work. We need people like that. There are people that get ministry in the kitchen. They get that. You know, they just like, I've got this revelation roast. I can make it tick. There's people that I understand financially. They've got wisdom. There's wise people that do the sound. Who knows what they do back there? But they look pretty smart, and they're doing it well. There's people up in the video room right now, right? There's Sunday school, some greeters. There's people that have wisdom in certain areas. God's just given you guys something special. Praise God for that. It's a special gift. We need that. There are some of you that are just incredibly wise in other areas that are just not letting the church have a piece of that. Folks, we want you. The church needs you. God doesn't need you. You need God. But he sure would love to use you for his glory. Sure would love to use you for his glory. So we're going to wrap up, but I'm just going to give you guys a quick summary. We saw the early church. And we like to look back and we say, oh, that First Baptist Church of Jerusalem, they were pretty perfect. Well, no, they weren't, right? There were some mistakes being made. They were growing so rapidly that they couldn't handle everything. And I remember I asked you at the very beginning, look back at this church, look back at Bryte Church. We've got some of that going on. We started a service. We don't even have Sunday school yet, right? We started a service. We're not sure how to handle some things. We're still trying to figure things out. Our community groups are going. We're trying to find leaders. We're still figuring things out. And the Spirit led that church then and said, well, you need to raise up leaders. I need you to appoint leaders. That's kind of where we're at right now. We're looking for leaders. We're looking for good people to step in and say, listen, I heard you, Pete. I heard you on Sunday. I heard God speaking through me through that passage in Acts 6. I need to answer my calling. Because without God, if you removed God out of my life, I would have nothing. My life would be miserable. I've got to become a part of this. And so that's where we end today, folks. Let's rise. We're going to pray. I'm going to ask the band to come up. I pray that God be glorified, folks. I pray that God be glorified because we do have the Spirit here. I believe that God is doing something very incredible amongst Bryte Church. Really, I really do. I hope that maybe in the next couple of weeks I could share some miracles that have been going on behind the scenes. Just outright miracles where the Spirit's come in and done crazy, crazy things. It's going to be awesome. We're here together on a ride as God forms his church here. But at the end of the day, you're either with us or not with us. And not just in ministry, folks. There's some of you here that came to hear the word of God. Somebody dragged you in, promised you a sandwich, and now you're sitting here thinking, where's the sandwich? It's all right. We've got you later on. But God wants your heart. God wants you to be a part of this community. And if you don't know Jesus today, we always say this. If you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, you know about Jesus, you think he's a great guy, you think he's a good person, that's fine. But if he has not saved you today, if you don't know for sure that if you die right now and you'll be in heaven, if Jesus comes before the end of the service and you won't be in heaven, folks, there's an opportunity today. There's folks with a tag that they can pray with you and can lead you in the right direction. Let's bow our hearts and let's pray.
The great I am, the Lord.
my soul eternally.
Boldly I approach.
Boldly I approach your throne. Blameless now I'm running home. By your blood I come, welcomed as your own, into the arms of majesty. Behold the bright and risen sun, more beauty than this world has known. I'm face to face with love himself, his perfect, spotless righteousness.
A thousand years, a thousand times
are not enough to sing his praise. Boldly I approach your now I'm running home. By your blood I come, welcomed as your own, into the arms of majesty.
This time is the respond time, and we're going to have a free will offering. And we always say this is actually for the members of our church. If you are new to our church the first time, we just want you to enjoy the service. We just want you to continue praising our God with our next song.
go on and scream it from the mountain. Go on and tell it to the masses that He is God.
I think this is what the sermon was all about. Let's sing it one more time. Shout it.
Shout it. Go on and scream.